fire of joy, bond of love, O breath of God, help our hearts remember. Purge our pride with your kindness, plant this song deep in us. For all the gifts, greater is the giver. Oh, give thanks to God forever, for all he's done, for all he's given, for every grace. Bring every praise to the giver of all. Give thanks to the giver.
Good morning.
All right, everybody got quiet.
Let's stand as we get started and sing.
Good morning. I'm glad you're here. I hope that you, wow, feel very powerful today. That's great. I was just talking a little bit here this morning and noticed I have a little rasp to my, did you make an audible noise when I said that? Did she make a noise? I shouted last night at a ball game, which I haven't done in a while because I learned a long time ago I can't afford to do that on Saturday. And then Sunday rolls around without fail. So you got to hide that better, dear. We talked about it last night, and I said to her, I'm doing that, and I'm going to be in trouble tomorrow. She said, yeah, you are. I'll be fine. Don't sweat it. But I'm glad you're here today. Hope you're feeling well and looking for bright eyes and smiles on your faces. Good. Looks like a good morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be here to worship you and to study your word. Most importantly today, that we can lift up your name and we can look into your word and hear from you today. Lord, may that be the case. May it not be our participation that shines. May it be your presence that shines. So in our singing, may we make much of you. In the word of God, may we give you the honor that you're worthy of. And then, Lord, help us to leave this place better fit to serve you and better fit to represent you to people who don't know you as Savior. Lord, I pray for all that takes place today, that we would put into it our best effort because you are worthy of that as well. And we ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen. You could be seated if you would, please. A couple of reminders from the bulletin. Next Sunday, we'll have missionaries here. We will be combined in here in the auditorium. Steve and Esther Napier will be here with us on the 4th. And then next Sunday night, we'll have a film night. I know it's not 5th Sunday, but you'll allow us to do that, kind of shuffle the calendar around. Reminder again, no Sun Coasters or Stitches of Love. We've combined those two. That'll be until further notice here in the month of September. We'll pick that back up. And this will probably be your last opportunity, this last Sunday opportunity to give for to donate diapers for the distribution of that. We'll do that in the next 10 days or so. And so if you could bring those in, we would appreciate it. And it rapidly comes. I know as soon as we put something in the bulletin that seems so far off, you know, we put in there September 18th. We did that a week or two ago. And you say, oh, that's ages from now. Well, guess what? The end of August is here. September starts in the middle of the week. And it'll be here before you know it. So you have to do that preliminary work of inviting people. Don't make it just one. Spread that invitation as broadly as you can and then follow up with it. It's a great way to do that as a reminder. Please do not rely on just what you see on social media. Be that personal contact. You work with people, your neighbors to people, your kids go to school together, you're spending social time together. Use those opportunities in the next 3 weeks or so to be that invitation. Hey, why don't you come to church? I know you haven't been since COVID. I know you haven't been in a long time. I know you had a bad experience when you were a kid. By the way, that one you will hear, if you ask, you will hear that. Someone that talks about that's the reason don't come anymore. Do that invitation if you would now and see if it doesn't profit some fruit in your spiritual walk in the days to come. Well, it's fall, y'all. Not really. I was just thinking of that. I want to do a little mini survey here. Has anyone changed house decorations yet to include a pumpkin a stalk of, what is it, hay, an ear of corn, anything like, no one? All right. Hold on. We have one. We have two. Yes, what do you got? Some what? And they're fall doilies and bowls? Is there a pumpkin on any of them? See, I said that because this morning I had a pumpkin coffee on the way in. And I'll tell you why. Anyone know the reason why besides my son? Yeah, not so much. It wasn't, who said free? It wasn't free, it was on sale. Yes, it was discounted greatly, and I said, you know what? If it was free, I'd drink them every day. That's fine, I don't have any problem with that. It was highly, greatly discounted, and so, you know, we'll go. What do you got there, the fall decorations already? A pumpkin, not a real one. Oh, because they're never going to make it, right? They won't make it till September if you put them out. And it is the, as I said a moment ago, it is the end of August, just about. We've got a few more days. I was thinking of that because we have had no named storms. We haven't had any, you know, breakup, anything like that. You're right? Well, I don't believe in superstition. I'm a pastor. I can't afford to do that. And I was thinking, well, it's, you know, August is something. It's not everything. We're a long way from November. But, you know, if you go back far enough, you had Andrew and you had Charlie, I think both August storms. And around here, someone was asking me the day, actually one of the police officers we were talking to during training, and we were talking about roofs and air conditionings, air conditioners. And I said, well, as far as roofs go, I know how to date our roofs for the most part to September of 2017 because of Hurricane Irma. So we did have a good month of August with the officers, and I appreciate you. And I wish that you could have heard their gratitude for letting them do the training here. It was a training that we don't like to think about. If there is an assailant in a school, a business, a place of worship, and every officer, almost every officer per shift was here, and they were four times a day, starting at 6 o'clock in the morning and running till 11 o'clock. I got home a little after 11 on Friday night, and I joked about it being fall because I, as most of you know, I announce high school football on Friday nights, about four or five games a year in the fall. And it's funny because football is fall, right? Did you guys go to the preseason game? Did it feel like fall? No, not at all. And I went on Friday night, and it's just, you know, oh, the sun's going to go down in a few minutes, and we'll get a little breeze because I'm up in a tower. I'll get a little breeze here. I'm zapped just standing there in the heat and the humidity. It was really oppressive on Friday night, it seemed like, and I laughed. Fall. I have family up in Ohio, and, you know, they say, hey, we're going to the high school football game, and we're bundling up, and there's a bonfire afterwards, and we are a long way from bonfires, if you know the truth of Florida, right? And we, you know, the question did come up, and we are planning to do some of the things that we haven't been able to do the last couple of years as the holidays approach, just to give you that heads up. And I hope you'll participate in them. And as, again, as we talked about back to church Sunday, be able to invite folks and start that process up in the people that you know and love. I'm going to ask a question. I don't have a prize. Let me look. I don't have any prizes to give you. I have a missionary letter, an American flag pen, some Kleenex. I can't give you my Kleenex. I'll need them before the morning's out. And a nation's flag, which apparently hasn't made it to a pole yet. It has red and white and blue, but it's not American. So I can't give any of that to you, but maybe I'll find something later. Anyone knows? Check what? There's a Chick-fil-A card. Ooh, all right, well, because I think there may be more than one that knows it. Anyone knows what I'm missing right now? As I stand here, I'm missing one thing. Carrie, what is it? Were you going to insult me, Carrie? I just wanted to know, were you going to say my brains or something like that? Could somebody else raise their hand here? Anyone knows what I'm missing? Dawn? I'm missing my wallet. Dawn, thank you, Miriam. Dawn, I have a Chick-fil-A card for you here. Well, that'll open up the answers this morning. Dawn, I'm going to put it right here. After the morning Sunday school, you come get it. Chick-fil-A, you got a nice meal. Some of you are right now baffled how Dawn knows I'm missing my wallet. Did you know I'm missing my wallet, Mary Beth? Tell her what has to happen, Dawn. Tell her. Thank you. I did a video this morning, and I was talking about our topic for this morning, about something that is lost, and I sat down to do the video, and I said, I forgot my wallet. I left the house without my wallet. So on the video that I posted, the church website, and then the church Facebook page, and then shared it, I said, that means Mary Beth has to pay for lunch. You didn't know it. You do now. So the question goes out then, have you ever lost anything of importance? And there's importance on two different sides. One is, I have to have this. I need it. We would all agree a wallet would fall into that category. By the way, apparently someone tried to order a Spirit Airline ticket this morning at 119 on my credit card because I woke up to the text. Well, it's no big deal. They didn't put it through because they know a middle of the night like that, that's probably suspect. I'm just going to say this, if you're really trying to hit me hard, a $69 Spirit Airline flight, if you're going to hit somebody else's, don't you go first class if it's somebody else's card you're trying to rip off? I'm thankful they didn't. So maybe that's why I left my wallet at home. Have you ever lost something of importance, meaning I've got to have this back in order to be able to function? There's another category that we talk about being important, and one, it's just sentimental. It's not anything I really use, but it was important to me. I can function without it, but I'm really sad that I lost it. Anybody have one of those two? What's the worst thing you ever lost, an item that you lost for value's sake? Becky? Oh, no, I know this one. Wow, this is going to hurt. Yeah, she lost the wedding ring. But Mike's a good guy. He's replaced it, right? He's replaced that thing several times over in rings. But anybody else? Bob? Dale lost her wedding ring. Yikes. You're still married, though. I want to give you a good hope. You're still married. Anybody else? You lost something of importance, value, significance? A set of keys. I saw you nod when I said that. Is that a recent thing? No. And so the process is what? You have to have all the work keys and everything too? Yeesh. Yes, ma'am. Wow. Wow. I on the other side of this, besides value, there are things that we lose sentiment. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. Okay, so here's a good Sunday school answer. Trust in people. I'm going to stay in the material realm, but that is a good answer. And we lose that a lot, don't we? When people fail us, it's hard to get that back. All right, how about the sentimental value? Oh, Christy's ready for this one. You lost something. You can get by without it. You don't have to replace it, but you miss it. Yeah. Hold on. He gave it to you from the 1800s, not in the 800s. You weren't here. I'm just making sure everybody knows. Yeah. It turned up missing. So if you couldn't hear that, when she went away to college, her dad gave her an 1800s era silver dollar, and she would show it to the students every year at school, and it turned up missing. Yeah, I mean, it was probably worth more than a dollar, obviously, a silver dollar. Yeah, but the sentimentality, my dad gave that to me, and it was marked an occasion as well, so double up. Who here? Marine? Yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. Tracy? Oh, man. Hold on. You're giving a ton of anxiety to a lot of people here that know what you're talking about. A lot of us just had a heart rate go up. And you lost the drive? Yikes. Yeah. Yeah, I know, and there's a thought that goes with it. That's a great answer that goes with this. Is it, you ever look at it and go, well, I never even look at those photos, but I get anxiety. So we have a cloud drive. It's redundant, which means there's two drives in it, and so it's supposed to be. I never trust it, that when you put something on there, it's actually dumping it onto the second one. So if this one fails, you can go and get it. But if you've ever lost a drive, you know what that is. And there, I confess this because years ago, we had the photos, obviously, and Mary Beth would put them in scrapbooks, and then we transitioned. So there was a period of time where you had the actual photo because you weren't used to the digital, and you had no way to show it. You know, you're carrying around that big, lunky computer to show people, hey, look at my pictures from vacation. So you still printed them out, and I'm concerned about that, you know. There is a whole foreign country trip that we took with Project Serve that I don't know where it is, and I get anxiety over that. So the topic this morning is from 2 Kings, and the question that we have to ask is, how do we respond? Because one of the things I've learned in ministry and in counseling and in my own personal life is sometimes the actual action is tough. It's difficult. It's incorrect. Sometimes I just flat out fail. But often what's more important than the initial failure is how I respond to that. So if you've ever learned that lesson the hard way, you realize, or you've seen it in someone else, is, yeah, I messed this up, but if I own up to it, I take accountability and responsibility, and I move forward with progress, we minimize the damage from the problem. But if I refuse to acknowledge I had any fault, I dig my heels in, I ignore the problem, I've made it worse. And so often what we counsel, especially young people, is get ahead of the problem once it's been made and bounce back from it. Find ways to be positive about it. We kind of see a bit of that in 2 Kings chapter 22 this morning, is how do we respond to that failure? But then the other question is, how do we respond to the Word of God? And you've heard me say this often in the pulpit. Every time that Jesus speaks in the Gospels, whether it's an individual that he's speaking to or whether it's a crowd of people, there is at the end of his speaking the expectation that at least some will respond. That's why he spoke. He was expecting them to respond in some way. In fact, you'll hear it in his words, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." He wants you to put it into action. How are you going to respond? And so every time we come in contact with the Word of God, we should ask ourselves this question: how will I respond? You say, "Pastor Matt, that's not really necessary. I'm just doing my 5-minute devotions in the morning." You're missing something. If you don't ask yourself, how do I respond to what I've just read, you're missing the application of it. You hear a sermon, you hear it taught in a class, or you read it on your own, and you say, well, that's great. That's wonderful. Can I just tell you this as a pastor? I'll give you a little transparency and insight. Some of you are very faithful to say things to me on the way out the door. I love it. I love the interaction. I love to see and thank you for being here. And I love when someone will say, I'm a human being. Hey, great message this morning. I love it. I appreciate it. You know what makes so much more impact in my life is when someone comes back 5 days later or the next week and they say, "Listen, what we talked about last Sunday in church, I had this come up in my life, and I was able to use what I read in Scripture and put this into..." Oh, I'm turning cartwheels in my office when I hear something like that. That's energy for the next 3 days when I hear that someone did that. Why? Because every time that we read the Word of God, there is the expectation that we should respond to it some way. So what happens in this text is, The people of God have lost the Word of God. Now, we're going to argue this. We're not going to argue, but we're going to talk this morning and say, well, is that of the value, like the price that we can put on it, or is that the sentimentality? I would argue that we're somewhere in the middle, that there is, yes, great sentimentality to it, but it was of greater value than they recognized. The lack of the Word of God in their midst led them to do all types of nonsense. And that's a kind word that I'm using. It led them to all types of destructive behavior and immorality and false worship and idolatry and flat-out paganism because they didn't recognize the Word of God. This is the discovery of Scripture that was lost. Can you imagine hearing from God's Word for the first time and realizing how badly you've disobeyed it? Now, I grew up in church. I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up in a Christian school. I knew how badly I had disobeyed, right? You had parents to tell you that you've disobeyed. You had teachers to tell you you've disobeyed, and they all linked it back to the Scripture. They could point out the verse that told you why you disobeyed God. Can you imagine some place in your life that first time you read the Bible and you went, "Wow, I'm really wrong. I really disobeyed, and I didn't know it." And we kind of see that in their response today. King Josiah, and we need to examine his response to the Word of God, and it would be wise for us to take a lesson from it. Look at verse 8, chapter 22 of 2 Kings, and beginning in verse 8, here are the steps that Josiah went through when he responded to the Word of God. So we're going to be wise hearers this morning, and we're going to say, how can I put this into practice? How should I respond in the same way? Number one is, he heard the scriptures. By the way, let's just stop there. He heard the scriptures. How many of you have ever heard someone talking, and when they were done, you had no idea what they had just said? Any spouses would like to admit that? Jason, you're going to let her do that, and you're not going to admit to it? Just checking. Okay. I'll confess, I remember when projectors had just started to be used in church ministries, and we didn't have it. How many of you remember the hooks are still there? You had that big hook that Don Watson had made, and we had to pull the screen down here, and then down here we had a slide projector that plugged into the floor, right about where you sat, Ruth. I mean, you know. And then all of a sudden, this new thing where you could project it on a screen. And then if you were around, when we transitioned, we had the cart up here, and we put that screen up there, but actually it was a screen that was in the baptistry. So then we got to take the hook from here, and we transitioned it to there, and somebody had to go up in the baptistry during the service and pull the screen. Come a long way, baby. And that cart was here, and I can remember thinking, well, what's the real purpose in it? How are we going to use it? And it was in its infancy. How would we use it? And I went to a preacher's meeting in Sarasota. I'll never forget it. And the pastor that was preaching that afternoon, now mind you, it was a better part of the day meeting on a Monday. So Mondays, I kind of recover a little bit physically, and I was younger then, and I would get up and I'd drive. This wasn't the worst drive. Sometimes you had to drive to the East Coast or down to South Florida or up to Jacksonville. This was just Sarasota. You'd have some services in the morning, and then you'd have lunch, and then you'd go back into the auditorium for a poor pastor to preach the sermon after lunch. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And I am a man just like any other. Trust me, it happens. And he was in the middle of his sermon. I was, I don't know what he's saying. I have no idea what his topic is. And they started to use that screen, and that screen would take me back to his point. Oh, I know what he's talking about because his words are up on the screen. Why? Because I heard him speaking for a while, and then my ears start to shut down and my eyes close, and I didn't hear it at all. First of all, you have to hear the word to be able to respond to it. And if you don't ever read the Bible, you don't have a chance. How are you going to respond to something that you don't ever hear? But Pastor, I'm here on Sunday. I'm here at 9:30. I applaud you. I'm grateful for it. I wish more were. And I know this is hard to take, but if this is your weekly interaction with the Word of God from Sunday morning to Sunday afternoon or even Sunday evening, you're missing something in your walk with God. The Bible has been given to us. All right, that's nothing to do with the lesson, but it does. Verse 8, let's look at it. Hilkiah, the high priest, said unto Shaphan, the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and he read it. And Shaphan the scribe came to the king and brought the king word again and said, thy servants have gathered the money that was found in the house and have delivered it into the hand of them that do the work, that have oversight of the house of the Lord. And Shaphan the scribe showed the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest hath delivered me a book, and Shaphan read it before the king. Well, we need a little clarification about who we're talking about. We read in that text that Hilkiah is the high priest. Shaphan is the scribe, and the king is Josiah. And we have this hierarchy of the work being done and the report being given. Josiah had commissioned work on the temple to repair the damage of it. If you've been here for several weeks, you remember where we are. People have been returned from captivity. They faced oppression. They faced people that didn't want the work to go on. But they wanted to build up not just the walls for the safety of Jerusalem, but they said, we're the people of Jehovah. We need to go take care of his house. If you were here, I think last week or the week before, the Lord chastised them. How come your houses are all completely furnished and my house is undone? And he called them back to that work. Well, in the process of it, somebody's uncovering and somebody's building and somebody's restructuring a wall. They found this book. Here's what had happened. In these intervening years, worship had not been taking place in the temple. Why? Well, number one, they weren't worshiping Jehovah. They were up on the high places and in the groves and at the altars that they'd built, worshiping Baal. And it had gotten so bad that the temple that was dedicated to Jehovah and to his worship had elements in it that reflected the worship of Baal and the other idols. They had allowed it to desecrate the temple. So they had to do we would call, both literally and figuratively, a deep cleaning. They had to get into every corner. They had to find anything that had remnants to their idolatry and get rid of it and build it back up. And all of a sudden, one day, he discovers this scroll. It's likely not the full scriptures that they had at that time, but at least a portion of it. And they said, "What have we got here?" I love to watch. I used to watch before all the cable channels had it, This Old House. You ever watch This Old House? I feel like I knew those guys by first name. I always, don't hate me for this, but I always felt bad when one of the segments was that big guy that did all the landscaping. Get in there and tear something out and do some plumbing and do some electrical. But that guy's out there planting trees. I want to see the meat and potatoes of this building, you know? And all of a sudden, sometimes they tear out walls in these old houses and they discover coins or newspapers or documents that someone had put in there and forgotten, or when the construction was going on, they left that back in there. I love discoveries like that. It's what happens here. During this repair, the passage of Scripture is found. How will they respond to it? Did you see the first thing they did? They said, "Let's read it. You read it. And not only should we read it, let's take it to King Josiah and read it before him." There will be no revival, there will be no repentance, there will be no turning back to God apart from Scripture. It doesn't seem like a coincidence that when the people left God for Baal worship, the Word of God was abandoned too. I'll tell you why it wasn't a coincidence. Because you won't read very long into the Scripture, especially the Scripture that they had, before you get convicted about what you're doing. How many commandments could they read without understanding that what they were doing was wrong? Anybody have an answer for that? Just one. By the way, you're going to get a double dose when you get to number two. No gods before me, no graven images. Strike two. There has to be a putting away of Scripture to be able to live that type of life that they were living. It's no surprise. So what does he do? Josiah, in verse 12, has three amazing responses. The king commanded Hilkiah the priest and Ahikam, the son of Shaphan. Now remember, that's the scribe that had already been partaking in this. And Achbor, the son of Micaiah, and Shaphan, the scribe, and Asahiah, a servant of the king's. So he puts together a little team. And he says to him in verse 13, "Go ye, inquire of the Lord for me, and for the people, and for all Judah, concerning the words of this book that is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord, of Jehovah, that is kindled against us, because our fathers have not hearkened unto the words of this book to do according unto all that is written concerning us." Here's what, it didn't take long. He read the book and he said, "We are in trouble. We're in deep, deep, deep trouble with our God." He knew. By the way, I think that conscience that God gives to every person speaks to us in the absence of Scripture. I think that even understanding what he knew of his fathers and his forefathers and his grandfathers, knowing where they had come from, because he still knows the story of the Exodus out of Egypt. He's not been completely separated from the past. But he recognizes, we have really messed this up. And we are in danger of judgment from the God that we've abandoned. Is he right? I think he is. So he puts together this team of leaders, Ahikam, that's the son of the scribe that was the reader of the Scripture, Achbor, Shaphan, the scribe who read the Scripture, and Asahiah, one of his officials. Why these four? Well, we can kind of guess. Shaphan understands the discovery. He knows that the Scripture is there. He knows enough to bring it and read it to the king, and knows that the son of this scribe, Ahikam, would have probably his dad's heart for the Scripture. I don't think that Ahikam could, Shaphan could read it and then go home and not say anything about it. He's probably heard it. His son's dad's really excited about something. And we don't know a lot about Achbor. We do know that Asahiah worked for the king. Josiah understands we've got to respond to this book that we've read, but I don't know what to do. I don't know how to respond. Think of this. He had been so disconnected from Scripture that he didn't know what to do next. Verse 13, he says, "Go inquire of the Lord for me and for the people and for all Judah." This means to go seek out a prophet from God, a prophet who's going to speak on God's behalf, and we're going to see it in verse 14. Go find a prophet to tell us what God wants. And look at the threefold concern that he has. For me, for the people, and for all Judah. I'll translate that for you here in common vernacular. We're in this together. I'm not going to escape the problems, and the people aren't going to. By the way, I think that's great leadership, don't you? I think that's great leadership. Thank you, Donna, Jason. You're getting a lot of attention over here. Thank you for being responsive. It's great leadership. Why? Because he doesn't say, hey, you all are in a heap of trouble. I'm gonna sick God on you. He says, I'm in the same condition. And you men here that I've assembled, you're in a bad way before God. In fact, all of us are. And by the way, I think this is a great response. Not only does he hear, but he inquires of God. He realizes the depths of his sin, and he turns to God. Here's a great question. What do you do after you realize you've sinned? Right? Well, yeah, I mean, that's a great Sunday school answer, but is that what we always do? Let me just ask this question. What does the flesh do when it realizes its sin? Hide? That's a great one. That's right out of Genesis. What else? Deny it. I got stereo right here. I like you, gentlemen. Stereo, deny. What else? Make excuses. Well, we got this flesh answer down here, don't we? Hide it. Cover it up. Ooh. We cover it so we think it's not going to be seen. Instead, Josiah says, we've got to turn to the Lord. And we go back to Maureen's answer here. The repent is where we get to. But he says, first, we've got to go inquire of the Lord on the behalf of the people. And then he says this, concerning the words of this book that is found. He's not inquiring of the Lord whether or not it's valid. He's not asking for determination from God. Is this really your word? He knows that already. He's not asking God, hey, God, should we obey this? He knows. We've got that down. This is from you, and we should obey it. But we're in trouble because we haven't been looking at it at all. I was thinking of this even this morning as I sat making that little video, as I was looking at my notes, and I thought, what would it take to be so removed from the Word of God? Now, many of you probably this morning have the Scripture on your phone. I see some of you looking at a tablet or looking at your phone. How many of you have a physical copy of your Bible? Just raise it up like we used to do in the old. Hey, there we go. We're going to do a sword drill? Oh, hold on. I got the tabs in this one. I can't. That's cheat. I always felt that was cheating in school. I'm a purist when it comes to my sword drills. No fingers stuck in the middle. You know that? You know all the tricks? Yeah, Andrew does. Not because it's Andrew, because we were probably raised the same way. We knew all the same tricks. I'm not condemning him. I'm there too. Consider how far you would have to get to not be able to access it. Right now on my phone, sitting over there on the desk, I have three apps that are downloaded to my phone that contain the Bible. Why three? Well, I use them for different things. One of them has other language, the Greek language for me, so I can look at that if I need to in a pinch. One of them has Strong's Concordance, and I can use that. Some of them have some tools. And the new version we use for services like today, if you're looking at Sunday morning service, it's on there, the scripture on there. So I have a few of them for different reasons. When I sat at my desk this morning and made that video, I just sat in that chair, and I looked from the right to the left, and I counted on the top of the conference desk and my desk and my computer desk, 9 Bibles that were on the top. Now, it doesn't make me holy. It doesn't make me special. They're there so I can hand some of them out. One of them that sits in front of the computer I can consult. Another one is plastic-coated pages with a camouflage cover in case I'm called away from my desk to go hunting at any moment, I guess. I don't know. And the ones on the desk, I have them there when I taught class. We could just hand them out to people, so they weren't really my use. Think of how hard it would be for us to get. I don't even know the Word of God. I never heard it. You can turn on the radio at any time and hear preaching. You can Google it on your computer. You can go to the Blue Letter Bible. Some of you do that. You're going to a website. It's everywhere. And the people here said, we don't even know it. We don't recognize it. But boy, when it hit, it sure hit. He's wanting to demonstrate his fear of the Lord. In verse 13, he says, "For great is the wrath of the Lord kindled against us, because our fathers have not hearkened unto the words of this book to do according unto all that is written concerning us." Now watch. Does this sound like blame shifting? A little bit. All he's doing here, he's not shifting blame. He's already taken responsibility. He's recognizing the beginnings of it. Somewhere before us, they put this away and never consulted it again. Somewhere before us, they lost it. By the way, this can happen generationally, right? It can happen culturally in a society where we disregard or put it away and future generations suffer because of it. This is what's happened here. He's not saying, well, we get a pass because it was our fathers. By the way, we in contemporary Christianity love this if we can shift the blame to someone else. We didn't do this. By the way, we did a whole lot more than we recognize. We live here in the 21st century. We say, well, you know, this all started back with our fathers and our granddads. They did this. They did that. They took prayer out of school. Listen, that's not going to get you very far. We're responsible. At any given time in the nation of Israel, there was a king who did as his fathers did and didn't consult with God. Guess what? He was just as guilty as his fathers. But there was always someone who would come along and didn't do as his father and didn't do as his grandfather and recognized, I have a responsibility to do for me. That's us. And so he fears the Lord because he recognizes judgment. I'd love to know just exactly what passages he was reading and how he applied it to his day. Can you imagine reading it for the first time and you start to read about no other gods before me and you start to read about the judgment on idolatry and paganism and false worship and you looked around and that's all you saw? Man, we are in trouble. He fears the Lord. Josiah's realization that the spiritual state of his nation is in tatters. And he understands God's will now, and he realizes how far apart those two things are. He knew that there would be a response from the Holy God of Israel. He knew God was obligated to justice. Now he says, what are we going to do? Here's our key. Hear the word, recognize our sin, and fear the Lord and say, what do I have to do now? To inquire of the Lord means that he sends them to go find a prophet. And go look at verse 14. This is the third step here. So Hilkiah the priest, Ahikam and Akbor and Shaphan and Asahiah went unto Huldah the prophetess, the wife of Shallum the son of Tikva, the son of Harhas, but we've got her lineage there, don't we? Keeper of the wardrobe. Cool, we know his job too. Now, she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college, and they communed with her. And she said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, tell the man that sent you to me, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will bring evil upon this place and upon the inhabitants thereof, even all the words of the book which the king of Judah hath read, because they have forsaken me, have burned incense unto other gods, that they might provoke me to anger with all the works of their hands. Therefore, my wrath shall be kindled against this place and shall not be quenched. Ouch. That's a tough thing to hear. I'm going to just pull a couple things out of there that struck me when I read it. The people were doing what they were doing because of the influence of nations around them. That's always the case. They were worshiping these gods, burning incense, offering things on the sacrifices because they'd learned it from other people. By the way, did that give them a pass? Not at all. I'm going to ask you it again because some of you weren't convinced. Did that give them a pass from judgment? Negative. Not at all. You still have choices. The second thing is what do you think their motivation was? I'm not sure that the people of Israel woke up one morning and said, let's figure out a way to make Jehovah as angry as possible towards us. Anybody ever here done that with your life? You woke up in the morning, let's just sink the ship. Not many. Well, there's a few. I've been questioning whether they did it on purpose. We don't wake up and say, man, I really hope that I get God upset at me today. I hope I get in line for some really righteous judgment. But did you see what he said when the prophet spoke the words of God? You did this to provoke me to anger. And they're looking and say, well, we didn't do it for that reason. We just wanted some other gods. But you knew better. Listen, if I'm responsible for it, I'm responsible for it. If someone says, where's my friend Mike? This is always the question. Mike, you pulled somebody over in your career in law enforcement. And they said, well, Officer Pullum, I didn't know it was 35. They get a pass? No. Why? They knew or should have known. The people aren't going to be able to look at Jehovah and go, well, we didn't know this whole thing about false idols. False. Two commandments deep, and you knew all you need to know. No other gods before me and no graven images. Strike two, you knew. And in knowing that, you should have known, thanks for the great answer, Mike, you should have known that you were provoking God. You ever raised two kids that were generally the same age in your house? And you put them in close proximity to each other? You ever put them in a back seat and go on a long trip? Hey, that's not fair. Don't look at your kids. You ever put them in close proximity in the back seat on a long road trip? You ever have one of them that knew exactly what they could do to provoke the other one? Adam is staring. Look straight on. He will not turn his head to the side. Don't look away, Adam. Keep it right here and you're safe. Rachel, you too. I saw the turnaround over here with the whites. What happens? That one kid knows, I know exactly what buttons to push. I know exactly what to say. How many of you grew up in the age where all you had to do was mimic your little brother? Woo! How many miles you could get out of that? I'm going to pull the car over, and then it didn't matter. Whatever my brother did, and it was vice versa. He'd do that to me. Just infuriates one of them. Now, by the way, can we all as adults say that's not that big a deal for somebody to, Chris is still iffy on that. I mean, it is a big deal. They knew what they were doing was provoking God. He told them. And so the judgment comes from God through the prophet. Because you forsook me, because you burned incense, because you provoked me to anger at the work of your hands. My wrath shall be kindled against this place and shall not be quenched. This is a tough thing to hear. Some people hear God's wrath, hear God's judgment, and they say, well, it's unfair. I've heard so many times people say, I can't believe in a God who would fill in the blank, right? I can't believe in a God who would judge, condemn. It's too harsh. It's unfair. The truth of the matter is God is righteous in holding people to account of the law that he gave. He's righteous to do it. And it's available for us to know. It reminds us that we cannot and we do not keep the law. The law is there not to make us righteous. The law is there to remind us how very short we fall from God. Law does a great job of that, wouldn't you agree? That law did a great job of reminding me, not to break me down and have me grovel, but to remind me that in myself, I'm not ever going to be right with God. I need some help. Good news. Stick around for 10:30. We'll talk about the help. Here's the last thing. Now, Josiah has a choice in all this. This is what we're talking about. How will I respond to God? How will I respond to the word that I've read? Because he realizes he's read it, he's heard it. He recognizes his sin. He inquires after God. And the fourth thing in his steps are he receives mercy. The prophet continues to talk on God's behalf. But there is judgment coming. But to the king of Judah, which sent you to inquire of the Lord, thus shall ye say to him, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, as touching the words which thou hast heard. This is concerning the judgment that you read about in that book. This is concerning the judgment that God has just reiterated will fall on Judah. Because thine heart was tender, thou hast humbled thyself before the Lord, when thou heardest what I spake against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, that they should become a desolation and a curse, and hast rent thy clothes and wept before me, I also have heard thee, saith the Lord. Behold, therefore, I will gather thee unto thy fathers, and thou shalt be gathered into thy grave in peace, and thine eyes shall not see all the evil which I shall bring upon this place. And they brought the king word again. God had a different word for King Josiah. not the judgment that he's talked about already, but notice what God says was important to him. Notice what God valued. Number one, a tender heart. He recognized in Josiah a tenderness of heart. How do we see it? How did we notice it? Man, as soon as he heard it, he was stricken. We're in trouble. We need to ask of God. Can I tell you the best thing? We talked about this a moment ago. It's not the fall into sin or the fall into the temptation to sin. It's how we respond next that makes a difference. Harden your heart and you'll pay. You'll pay all of it. Harden your heart. Dig your heels in. Cover it. Hide it. Deflect it, justify it, all those answers we gave before, and you'll stand righteously in the place of judgment before God. It's coming. But he had a tender heart. That's what God values. Number two, humility. He recognized who he was in relationship to God and his law. You have to know who you are and who you're not. What would be the particular temptation for Josiah being the king? Well, that's the word, right? The temptation for him to think more of himself than he was. Hey, wait a minute. I am the king of the children of God. I get a pass. I'm the king. He recognized who he was. I may be king, but I'm not God. We're all in this, he says, for me. Inquire for me. Inquire for the people. Inquire for the people of Judah. He says, I'm just a man. I may be the king. I may have been anointed, but I stand under this judgment righteously. Be really careful when you go to God that we don't get big heads. God's not impressed with our inflated egos. It'll just get us in trouble. He recognizes, he hears, he has a tender heart, he has humility. And then what does he do? He has an outward expression. The Lord's message says, you rent your clothes. That was a public display of mourning. It was a new understanding of God's will. It was a new understanding of the disobedience of the nation, and it gave attention to it. And so, Pastor Matt, do we have to tear our clothes when we're really sorry over sin? Do we have to put sackcloth on? Good luck finding sackcloth. I don't know. We don't get our flour in those bags anymore. Do I have to put ashes on my head and grovel and cry out in the streets? No, that's not the point. But the point was he was willing to demonstrate it. Rather than to hide, rather than to put on airs, rather than to pretend to be something he wasn't, he was not afraid to say, I'm sinful and I am standing before a holy God. Oh, how much better off we would be when we say that quickly. He's humble. He has a tender heart. He rends his clothes and then he weeps. This is a sincere, genuine response of emotion and sadness over this situation. And it was for this reason that God tells Josiah that the judgment that is coming, the righteous judgment that will be delivered, it will be fair by every account, he's not going to see it. Still has to break his heart, doesn't it? He served this people his whole life. It still has to break his heart that it's coming. But God says, in response to how you have responded, you'll be gathered into the grave in peace. What does it mean? You're going to die. You're going to be gathered to your fathers before this judgment comes, and you won't have to see it. You won't have to endure it. It's a simple token by God, a simple recognition. By the way, it is probably given, at least in part, for the edification and the instruction of generations that will come. How should I respond when I'm sinful before God? Josiah's life gives me a lesson. Do I love God? Do I love his word? When I hear the sound Bible preaching and teaching, am I ever moved to respond to it? When I open the book for my devotions and I spend my time with God, do I ever look into that and say, God, how do you want me to respond? You know, one of the things I was always taught, and I'll wrap up with this. One of the things I was always taught was, you know, when you read the Bible, before you start reading it in your devotion time, ask God, what do you want to teach me? You know, one of the things we leave out in that equation is when I'm done reading it, asking God, how do you want me to act now? Some of it's self-explanatory. But I have to ask God, even at the beginning, God, not only let me understand it, but help me know what to do with it. What do you want me to do with it once I've read it? When I hear that, when was the last time you responded in repentance or in response to the word of God, whether that's privately or in the public preaching of it? When was the last time your heart was moved to do something about it? Beyond just nodding and giving, by the way, I love it, I love it. Beyond just walking out and saying, well, that was the word of God was really meaningful to me today. what am I going to do with it? Josiah had to answer it. Josiah was blessed in a way because he answered it properly. Heavenly Father, help us every time we read the word. And first of all, help us not to put it aside like the people of Judah did, to forget it, to abandon it, and to live generations without even discovering it. But Lord, we have it. It's everywhere. We take it for granted. It sits on our shelves. It's on our phones. It's on our computers and our tablets. And we can hear it on the radio, see it on the screen. Lord, help us not to take it for granted because it's so prevalent in our lives. But Lord, when we do read it, may we have a response, especially to sin and the righteousness of you, that we have that proper response of being humbled before you and repentant hearts before you and quickly inquiring of you, God, what would you have me to do? Sometimes we know it already. We know it as soon as we read the verse. Help us then to have the courage to put it into practice. But Lord, let us always be asking of you, how would you have me to respond? Even this morning and this hour to follow, help us to do that at every stage of this service. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.